थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू सो मच.
नमस्कार.
वी फील ऑनर्ड एंड प्रिविलेज टू हैव यू अमंगस्ट अस. एंड नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू इंट्रोड्यूस डॉक्टर रजनीश मिश्रा. प्रोफेसर रजनीश कुमार मिश्रा टीचर्स एट स्कूल ऑफ संस्कृत एंड इंडिक स्टडीज, JNU, न्यू दिल्ली. हिज टीचिंग एंड रिसर्च एरियाज इन्वॉल्व कश्मीर शैविज्म, बुद्धिज्म, संस्कृत लिंग्विस्टिक्स, संस्कृत पोएटिक्स, एशियन लिटरेचर, फिलोसफी ऑफ लैंग्वेज, कंपैरेटिव पोएटिक्स एंड कंपैरेटिव रिलीजन. डॉक्टर मिश्रा इज एसोसिएटेड विथ नेशनल एंड इंटरनेशनल एकेडमिक प्रोजेक्ट्स सच एज एनसाइक्लोपीडिया ऑफ हिंदुइज्म, एनसाइक्लोपीडिया ऑफ इंडियन पोएटिक्स, Towards Asian Poetics, an interface study of India, Korea, China, and Japan, Indo-Irish anthology, and a comprehensive study of culture, philosophy, literature, and languages in Jammu and Kashmir. He has published a widely reviewed book titled Buddhist Theory of Meaning and Literary Analysis, which was published in the year 1999, and Shaiva Philosophy and Literary Theory, which was published in 2019. He has published several research papers in national and international journals. He also contributed chapters in the edited book and proceedings, and has delivered invited lectures. Dr. Mishra was awarded Okita Memorial Fellowship by Japan Foundation and the Indian Council of Cultural Relations in 1998. Sir, thank you so much for being a part of this FDP and kindly take over the session. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Nandini. Thank you. And it's my privilege to be with you and share a few of my thoughts. I thank the organizers and particularly Tineji for inviting me to be a part of this very, very important.
Rashmika, welcome to Unbagged.
Someone's mic is open.
Dear participants, I would request you to kindly mute your microphone. A lecture is going on. Thank you.
Yes, sir. We have muted. Okay. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. It's okay. It is always to be interactive. It's so useful, isn't it? Anyways, so the topic which is given to me, or rather I have selected for myself, is issues in research methodology, Indian conceptual framework, right? I have been attending some of the sessions of this FDP, and I am really delighted to see the presentations, and I have learned a lot from the presentation of the scholars who have spoken before me. To my mind, as I have been teaching this course on research methodology in JNU, Jawaharlal Nehru University, for more than, let us say, 15 years or so, my understanding of this theme is, in fact, it has been formulated, constituted by both the streams, what we call Indian intellectual tradition, as well as the Western modes and methods of doing research. And particularly in the social sciences, we follow a pattern of that I know you have discussed a lot in that area, so there is no point to repeat them. But my understanding is that there cannot be one single mode or method which can be applied universally. You have to adapt that mode. Okay, basic framework are same. There is no dispute about it. But depending on the theme of your research or the domain of research or the research in a particular intellectual domain or tradition, you have to really adapt to that framework, you know, modify here and there, you know. So that is very important. See, we are going to analyze a situation or a reality which is before us. That is our goal. And method or methodology is just a means to do that, you know. So quite often we feel that this particular method is not competent enough to analyze what I am going to do in the name of research. So next we have modify it. We have to adjust. Instead of controlling the data or let us say making changes in the data itself will lead us to a very erroneous kind of conclusion. So that we should not do. Data is very, very important for us. In that case, the reality which we are going to expound or analyze, that is very, very important for us. Methodology can be modified, of course. Methodology is not something which is static or which is sacrosanct. It is given, that's why nothing can be, and everything has to be accommodated within the framework of the theory of the or the method. That would be a wrong approach. A method or a methodology emerges out of the data. You know? So that is the primary understanding of the thing. So let me begin. In my understanding, research is simply desire to know, you know, jigyasa, what we call in our own term, jigyasa. That's why most of our intellectual texts or philosophical texts, let us say, begin with this term. For example, Vedanta Sutra begins with Athato Brahma Jigyasa, or Mimamsa begins with Athato Dharma Jigyasa. So jigyasa, what is Brahma, what is Dharma? Let us have a desire to know that. And when we say jigyasa, it is a prerequisite that we are shedding off or we are giving away all our preconditions, you know, all our presumptions, all our, you know, strong assumptions, which may interfere in going through or analyzing the data. So that means without any strong presumptions, we have to enter into the domain. This is just to help us ourselves to understand, to know what there is. Now the question is, what is there to know? What is there to know? If I speak from the point of view of our intellectual texts, then it is the truth. Truth at various levels, at the level of society, at the level of, let us say, philosophy or many other domains. So, satya toyev vijigyasitavyam. This is the truth which must be known, about which we should have a desire to know. So, this is important. And India, for example, as I was just telling you, that doing a research in an intellectual tradition means very, very, I mean, important part of it. That means when we are doing research in a context like, I'm sorry, I don't have slide, but I will keep repeating things, you know.
It's absolutely fine, sir. Thank you so much.
Wherever you have any difficulty in understanding any term, I will repeat, no problem, just let me know. So, what is to be known? It is the truth. And the second is Atman. India, as I was telling you, that it's an intellectual tradition. India is a knowledge-centered civilization. Knowledge-centered civilization. I will explain, I think, a couple of minutes later. knowledge-centered civilization. So, in this domain, what is important to know is the self. It is the knowledge of the self. Adhyatmik, adhi-atman. Everything is centered around the question of the self. Who am I? Like this. Without answering this question, it will be difficult, or it will be rather futile, to discuss lots of things around us. So the primary emphasis is on the knower itself, or himself or herself, whatever life. So Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says, Atma va re drashtabhya, shrotabhyo mantabhyo nididhyasitabhyah. This is the Atman, which is to be seen, which means to be known, to be heard, means to heard from the various knowledge texts as a source. And mantabhyo, there is a need to reflect upon it, whatever we have studied from the various knowledge texts or sources or from the teacher, we need to reflect upon it. And vijigyasitabhya means accordingly we have to proceed in our day-to-day life. Even one has to practice this, only then the truth can be achieved. And the emphasis is always on that question that could lead us to knowledge of everything. So statements like yasmin gyate sati sarvam gyatam bhavati, so by knowing which everything is known, let us know that, let us try to know that object, that knowable, by knowing which everything is known, like that. In the same way, Mundaka Upanishad talks about, there is a interesting dialogue between two seers, rishis, and the question is something like this: what is that knowing which everything is known? Kasmin no bhago vigyate sarvvidam vigyatam bhavatiti. This is the question. And answer to this question is equally brilliant. It says that the other rishi says that I don't know much, but what I have heard from the predecessors, great seers earlier, is like this. There are two disciplines, knowledge disciplines, para and apara. These two knowledge disciplines must be, or should be rather, known. Para is experiential reality, the reality which we experience, and apara is reality that which we can talk about, or others have talked about it. So knowing that one is also important. So whole textual tradition, including Ved, Upanishad, Brahman, Aranyak, and a whole Shastra tradition is included under apara, and that which is only experiential, which we have understood, which we have experienced ourselves, is that is paravidya. So this has been the debate. And what is the goal? Goal is to know what we know as valid knowledge, prama, as Nyaya philosophy puts it. Prama means valid knowledge or validated knowledge, let us say. If this is the real experience. This is quite simple to understand, that we are determined to know X as X, not X as Y. Tat prakarata tadvati. That which is there, we have to know as the object is, as it is in Plato's philosophy, as it is, or in Aristotle, three modes of representation, as he talks about, as it is, as it appears, as it ought to be. Three modes of representation he talks about in his Poetics. So like that. So we have to establish, we have to know what is prama, or the valid knowledge. Now, as I was telling you, that India is a knowledge-centered civilization. It is in the same sense as we call it the West, or particularly the Greeks, ancient Greeks. They also they formed a knowledge-centered civilization. I'm talking about ancient Greece, not medieval Greece or modern Greece. There is lots of oppositions between them. ancient Greece and modern Greece are just in opposition to each other today. So I'm talking about that Greece, which is ancient, which is pre-Renaissance, particularly. And Greece has always been a part of Oriental culture. They were made Western only during the Renaissance period. Most of you have read about it. So that's another story. So it is a knowledge-centered civilization. Fenson had remarked once that the country in the world most admired by the learned people is India. So you can understand. So this has been the centrality of knowledge in our culture. And that's why knowledge is supreme in the sense that it liberates us. What is liberation? In the sense that it helps us to come out of our immediate limitations. So as in Gita, Bhagavan Krishna says that nahi gyanena sadrisham pavitram mihi vidyate. There is nothing like knowledge, nothing like knowledge that purifies so much, you know. So knowledge is a great purifier. It liberates us from our narrow self. That's why we need this, you know. Our as the great seer or thinker from Kashmir, 10th, 11th century, Acharya Abhinav Gupta puts it, ihi gyanam moksha karanam, that this knowledge is the ultimate cause of liberation. Ultimate cause of liberation. And liberation is not something very mystic. It is just to getting rid of our narrow self, you know, narrow self. Swarup prathanam is the, you know, Gupta again says that it is the expansion of the self. We are always expanded due to some reasons. Our self appears something like narrowed, and we live in that, and there are lots of, you know, suffering due to that. So this is the important, you know, Bharat, the meaning of the word Bharat itself indicates you the knowledge tradition, the knowledge. Bhar means what? Light, knowledge. And the culture which is devoted in that, in acquiring knowledge, excelling in different various branches of knowledge is Bharata. The first text in our culture, we named it Veda. Veda literally means knowledge. So this has been the tradition in which we have been brought up. And Shruti, Veda also says that Brahmanena Nishkarano Dharma. See this approach to knowledge. Nishkarano Dharma Shadango Veda Dhyo Geyascha. A Brahmin, not by caste. Please mind. A person who has desire to know. That one is a Brahmin. One who knows Brahman or ultimate self is a Brahmin. So a Brahmin should know all the six limbs of the Vedas. And what are these six limbs of the Vedas? Phonetics, etymology, grammar, prosody, social thought, and astronomy. These are all secular in today's terminology. So a Brahmin should know all these six limbs of the Vedas even without any purpose. So knowledge is not acquired with a particular purpose. Always, what will be the outcome, how it is going to be beneficial for me or anyone. So knowledge is supreme goal, and it can be acquired even without asking question, how much package I'm going to, or how much salary I'm going to get it out of this. So this is the characteristics of a knowledge culture I was talking about. Now, in research, in this background, asking a pertinent question, right question, framing a right question is very, very important. So before we put a question to someone, we should examine it properly, because the person who asks questions first reveals his or her own level of understanding of the things first. And accordingly, the answer will be also framed by the learned person. You know, so it is a question, framing of question will be possible only after lots of reading and reflection, or one can say reflective reading. Let us say reflecting, dialogic reading. What is dialogic reading? We should establish a dialogue with the text which we are going through, interacting with the text, something like that. And as you know, explaining to others is always easier than understanding for one's own self. So one, the knower or the researcher himself or herself can understand, can examine his or her own understanding without any prejudice. So this is important. And important from the exponent's point of view, it is again important to what extent one an object can be expounded or explained. There is a limitation to that also. Not everything can be explained. So rest of the things one has to understand or make an effort to understand things. I'll just give you a glimpse of the type of questions which have been framed in our text. There are two sources I have selected so far, right, for this lecture. One is in the Mahabharata, Vanapala. You know, there is a dialogue between Yaksha and Yudhishthir. So you see, the kind of question Yaksha frames and the way it is responded by Yudhishthir, that is ideal. One should go through that. Yaksha Yudhishthir Samvad, dialogue between Yaksha and Yudhishthira. So that's a long chapter, and you will really enjoy. Second thing which I'm going to tell you is the types of questions which are given in two Buddhist sources. One is Abhidharma Kosha by Vasubandhu, a great Buddhist philosopher. And another is by Nagasen, prior to Vasubandhu, Milind Panho. This is a Sanskrit Prakrit hybrid text. As you know, that King Menander invaded India at that time, king of Bactria, he was, and he invaded India. And then he came to in contact with, a Buddhist philosopher called Nagasen. And then he asked questions and Nagasen answers to that. So it's a beautiful text. One should go, in English translation, you will also find this text, Question of King Menander. If you search it out, you will find it on the net. So in this text, it is said that there are four types of questions. First is ekansh vyakaraniye. That question, which can be answered in terms of yes or no. Yes or no question, one can easily understand. So for example, if somebody asks, does everyone who is born will die? The answer is yes. Accordingly, answer could be no. This depends on the question, yes or no question. It can be categorically said yes or no. Second is vivajya vyakarani, splitting. By splitting the question, you have to answer. For example, does everyone take birth after the death? This is a relative question. So one has to split this question. The response will be relative. For example, that person who is free from suffering will not take birth. So this is one part. And the person who is involved with many mental engagements or suffering will take birth. So the same question will be answered or responded in two different ways, yes or no, right? So this is called by splitting the question. Third, pratipriccha vyakaraniya, by asking a counter question. by asking a counter question, third type of question. So, for example, is the question, is the human being superior or inferior? So then one has to ask in what context you are asking, with reference to what you are asking. If you are asking with reference to God, human being may be inferior. If you are asking to other animals, then may be superior, like that. So by asking question, you can answer to this type of question. Now the fourth type of question is called sthapaniye. Sthapaniye or avyakrita. This is something like extreme questions. And the position in response to this question, if a position is taken, that will only generate debate and inconclusive debate. So it is called sthapaniye or avyakrita, that cannot be explained, this type of question. So while Mahatma Buddha was residing in Shravasti, Malukya Putta, one intellectual of that time, one can say, he asked him 10 such questions, that what is the, when the creation started, or when it will end, what is the ultimate reality, what is the origin of the soul, something like that, 10 questions. And in response to that, Buddha maintained silence. Why? Because if you ask answering to this question, then what will happen? It will generate counter argument. So such questions are to be understood or answered by silence. Why by silence? Because this is the answer is something like experiential. One has to experience it. One has to understand by intuition, by reflection or so. This is quite an individual's effort. So if somebody is going to explain to me or anyone, this will not take us anyway. So maintaining silence on such issues, in our intellectual texts, you'll find many such references. Abhinav Gupta himself says, that I will not explain this beyond this point because this is not permitted in our tradition of learned teachers. So it is like that. So one can understand it. And I'm reminded of Bacon, who said that a prudent question is one half of the wisdom. So asking correct question in a research is very, very important. In whatever domain one is doing research, or writing papers or so. So this is very, very important. Then you'll see there are two types of themes. I'm sorry, someone's mic is open.
I have a request to the participants, kindly mute your mic because it is creating a lot of disturbances. Hope you can understand. I'm repeatedly writing in the chat box. So please bear with us and please allow us to continue the discussion. And I'm really sorry, sir, for this kind of disturbance.
In any way, I'm going to wind up in next 10 minutes. And the rest of the things we'll have take up in if there are some questions, right? Again, there are two types of theme in research. One theme which is empirical, which is based on observation. So this kind of research can be mapped. You can map the progress in the research. For example, you have to make hypothesis, data collection, analysis, like that. So there are steps involved and you can always map at what level my research is. But on the other hand, there are themes or topics which are reflective in nature and they are very difficult to map. And in most of the cases, we face great difficulty in handling such themes. So without understanding of the whole domain, and arriving at a particular conclusion, not even a single line will be possible to write. to begin, I mean, this kind of research writing. So there are two types. First type is, if I take the terminology from our own text, for the first type, mappable research, it is something like the seers, Vedic seers are also classified into two, Mantravetta and Atmavetta Rishi. I am referring to Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Mantravetta, Narad Sanat Kumar Sambad, you know. So Mantravetta and Atmavetta Rishi. Mantravetta, Narad says that I have studied all the 14 knowledge disciplines by great teachers, but I have no peace in my heart. So what should I do? Then Sanat Kumar, the another great seer, he says that you have known these disciplines only by words. You are Sabdavit, Shabdavit. You have known these disciplines by words only, not you, that you have also experienced them. So the other category of the Rishi is Atmavetta, Mantravetta and Atmavetta. So accordingly, domains are also divided. So reflective researches, without understanding that domain, it won't be possible to write even a single line. So it is very, very important for researchers to know. Now, the question, as you know, during meta, during the NESA also, we, in the Western tradition, we have been asking, scholars have been asking that whether God exists or not. That's another thing. That is ontological question. God is an ontological object. Now, how do we know whether God exists or God doesn't exist? Now, the question of how becomes more important than the question of what. You know, how becomes more important than what. So there is a whole shift from ontology to epistemology during Renaissance. And great thinkers like Bacon, Francis Bacon, Descartes, and others, they are in, they are engaged in finding the right or proper epistemology, search for epistemology. Because without knowing how we have arrived at this particular understanding, nothing can be justified. So in Indian knowledge tradition also, you have pramata, knower. Knowledge is constituted by these components. You see, knower, that is pramata, pramana, that is means of knowledge. Third is prameya, the object of knowledge. And finally, the valid knowledge, prama. So this is pramata, pramana, prameya, and prama itself. And what is pramata? Pramata is the knower. So one has to examine one's own self in the beginning, his or her own level, and accordingly, one should arrive at a particular understanding as a knower. Only then one or someone is suitable for, continuing a research in that particular domain. Second is pramana. And what is pramana? Apurvarth vishyam khalu pramanam, that which establishes something which has not been established earlier. Something is not, was not established earlier. So there is always a sense of novelty. So that which helps us to establish which has not been established earlier, the way it is being established now, is called means of knowledge, pramanam. Anadhigat vishyam pramanam gyatartham prakashova, that which has not been studied, known so far, is being established, and the instrument that helps us to establish it is called pramana. And right from the beginning, people have been discussing this this framework, how to arrive at a particular conclusion. And it has been said, vade vade jayate tatva bodha, when you engage in disputation, discuss or debate on that theme, finally the truth will come out, truth will be established. So the Shastra tradition, the intellectual tradition, is constituted in a like Purva Paksha and Uttar Paksha. Purvapaksha means the view given by other schools of thought, and Uttarpaksha the domain or the position of the exponent himself. So, for example, a scholar of Kashmir Shaivism is writing a text, then maybe other schools of thought like Baudh, Nyaya, Jain, Mimamsa, they will be the Purvapaksha. This is called Purvapaksha. It's a giving, it is the way, this is the way to give honor to the opponent's view, let us say, or the other view, so that one can engage in dialogue, debate, and finally the truth can be established. So this is called Vaad Parampara. This is very, very important. Vaad Parampara, the tradition of disputation, not dispute, disputation. So both Purvapaksha and Uttarpaksha are engaged in a fruitful dialogue, and both are trying their best to establish the truth, taking a valid position. Now, deviant from this vada is it called Jalp. Jalp is that whether both Purvapaksha and Uttarpaksha are engaged in winning over another. So they take recourse to various other modes like chal, nigrah, jati. It is discussed in the Nyaya philosophy. You can read it. Now, the third is even more dangerous. It is called Vitanda. Vitanda is you are engaged in a debate which is just inconclusive. You are taking there is no theme before us now. You are just deviating from one theme to another theme, and the result is just inconclusive. So you are reaching nowhere. You are engaging in dialogue, debating and for long, but you are not reaching at any point. So this is called Vitanda. So one should take a course to Vada, and then it is called Nyaya. Pramanarth, Parikshanam, Nyaya. Pramano ki pariksha karna, the examination of the validity of the means of knowledge is called Nyaya. This is Nyaya Bhashya on the very first sutra of Nyaya Sutra. So examining the means of knowledge is also very, very important. And you know, the great Buddhist philosopher Nagarjuna, in first century AD, he had demolished all the epistemological framework in Buddhist tradition and in Indian philosophy. That's why his another name is Pramana Vidvansak Acharya. Why? Because he examined it so rigidly that no Praman sustained that is capable or competent of establishing the truth. You know, so these means also have some limitations. And when we talk about truth or reality by knowing through a particular means of knowledge, then we forget that we are talking about something which is a relative reality, not absolute. Because the reality is determined by the competence or incompetence of these means of knowledge, which we are applying to know that. You know, so knowing by perception, knowing by inference, knowing by verbal testimony, knowing by postulations, you know, this will generate different kinds of knowledge of the same reality. So it is very, very important to examine the Pramana also. And Indian philosophers in India's intellectual tradition, this is a very, very rich domain where this discussion has been made. Then you see, there are five steps one can, I'm just referring to them quickly. First is, what is the inferential process? Establishing something at the end of the research. First is pratigya. It is called the proposition which is to be proved. So first is pratigya, proposition, which we are going to validate or prove. So, for example, there is fire on the mountain, for example. If this is the statement, then we have to prove it. How we are going to prove it? The second step will be hetu, the cause of this. So, we are in search of the ultimate cause or the real cause for this. The reason for such cognition. Why did I cognize that there is fire on the mountain? So finding the competent or most important hetu or cause. Third is udaharan, examples. Have I seen such examples? Once I established the hetu, we have to examine whether this is the right cause or this is illusory cause. So we have to examine the concomitance between hetu and sadhya. Sadhya means that which we are going to establish. So we have to see whether such examples I have also seen in reality elsewhere in the world. Then quickly comes to my mind that, okay, I have seen it in the kitchen also, that there was a fire and there was smoke. So this is the example. Now, upanaya. Fourth is called upanaya, the application of the vyapti gyan, or that which is established in the present context, that I have seen this earlier in the kitchen, that there was fire and there was a smoke. The same thing I am applying to this situation, that there is fire on the mountain. So I can see only what is visible to me. The visible thing is just smoke. And by seeing that smoke, we are inferring fire. So the object is to infer fire. This is called a linga, or just an indicator. Smoke is just a indicator, hetu. So I'm applying the knowledge of my earlier experience to this present context. And finally, nigaman, that is the conclusion part of it. So conclusion which is drawn from preceding premises, such as therefore fire is on the mountain. So first I said that there is fire on the mountain, then search for, because there is a smoke in the mountain, this will be the hetu cause, the smoke is the cause. And then example, so just like in kitchen, there was fire and that's why I have seen a smoke. And applying that experience in the context, in the present context, that the mountain is also smoky, and that's why the final conclusion is, therefore, there is fire on the mountain. So this is called logical consistency. In writing a research paper or research thesis, one has to go for this logical consistency. There is a rhythm in language, there is a rhythm in ideas. They should, they go together. Once the rhythm in language is disturbed, I mean the progression is disturbed, this is the reflection that somewhere the rhythm of idea is also somehow it got disrupted. So by applying these things, one can achieve, because research is not just a one-time thing. One has to go about it. We have to write research papers and other research works throughout our academic life. So one should guide research students. So these are some fruitful tips. And I think I should stop here because my time is over. I wanted to talk about Plato's ontology, the line image, as it is popularly known in Republic Book 6. And another is in Book 7, that is the cave image. I request you to correlate these two episodes with their current discussions which I have made. Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for this enriching and enlightening presentation. I hope that our participants, they have come to know about a lot of new insights, and so they can also apply this kind of insights to enhance the criticalities and problematic in their respective research papers. So I have one query from my side, which I will ask you. But before that, there is one question. I'm reading that question for you. What kinds of similarities and dissimilarities can one notice between ancient Indian and Greek knowledge systems? This question is asked by Dr. Shantanu De.
Okay, very good question. And lots of similarities, in fact, lots of similarities. As I told you, Greece is in opposition, ancient Greece and modern Greece, you know. Ancient Greece was really an intellectual civilization, where you see, take any dialogue of Plato, for example, or works of any philosopher, Greek philosopher. They do not accept something by virtue of that, because it is established earlier. They examine it. And finally, by means of logic, particularly, by examining it, it is established. Philosophy, that's why the Greeks very proudly say that philosophy is our contribution to the world. And there is no exaggeration. We should not say darshan is also like that. Darshan is a different domain, slightly different domain, of course. Only one aspect of darshan is, that matches with philosophy, and that is anvikshiki, logical reasoning. So that is very important. So ancient Greeks were devoted to this kind of logical reasoning, and they would establish everything by examining things critically or logically. So that's why in any dialogue of Plato, you don't find the quotations from the earlier philosophers. And by means of that quotation, he is establishing his own view. No, he would examine that statement, even made by the earlier scholars or philosophers. And probably they don't quote from any scriptures. There is hardly any quotation from any scripture. So Greeks were radical in that sense. And rigorous examination, because the idea is to establish the truth, you know. So that is very important. And the same kind of impulse, you know, you'll find in India also, you know. That's why philosophical systems like Nyaya, Mimamsa, and various other schools, they developed on the basis of this logical reasoning. Take any text, intellectual text in our culture, you'll find that there is a rigorous method of examining things, a rigorous method, you know. And they write in the form of dialogue. There is self-dialogue, dialogue with the self, let us put it like this. Text is composed in the form of dialogue with the self. So they would raise all the possible questions, as it will be raised later on by the other schools of thought. So they would raise all the possible questions and they would try to respond to that. So in this way, so far knowledge is concerned, both the civilizations put very, very important emphasis, or they could recognize the centrality of knowledge for their culture. However, the modes are different. Modes are, of course, different, because in Greece, you have logical reasoning. In India, logical reasoning is fine, but there is a need to transcend this logical framework also. So they would transcend wherever it is possible. Okay?
Thank you.